Hi, I'm Micah Larsen, and I help women business owners be taken seriously and get buy-in. I'm a mom, an entrepreneur, and a social scientist. But before I was a business owner, I studied persuasion, or the best ways to use psychology to get people to do things like have safe sex, donate their organs, or wear a seatbelt. In order for you to be a good manager or a leader, it's really helpful to know how to persuade people to buy into ideas and achieve their goals. And motivation is a big part of that persuasion. So first, I'll tell you a little bit about what motivation is and how we are motivated. Then I'll tell you about the two types of motivation, how you can use them, and things you should remember as a leader who'd like to motivate others. In order to know how to motivate people, you need to know how people came to be motivated in the first place. We're all born with internal drives to do basic things to survive. Our human ancestors just wanted to kill stuff, eat it, and have sex because those things keep them alive. But as we became a little more sophisticated, we were also motivated to have good relationships with people so we could live in groups. We were motivated to learn to cooperate and not lie and steal, and those motivations are built into our brains. So later, we became motivated by something called the law of approach and avoidance, or rewards and punishments. We're motivated to get rewards and avoid punishments. We'll approach or move toward things that seem like rewards, and we'll try to avoid things that seem like punishment. We'll try to get things like money or coupons or an extra day off work, and we'll try to avoid pain, discomfort, and stress. This really came into play during the Industrial Revolution when we started to automate businesses and make factories. People realized they could make more money than ever, and bosses started to think about how to motivate workers to be more productive with rewards and punishments, like giving bonuses or docking pay. We've been stuck in this idea of motivation for a long time. A lot of times in a business setting, we still think about how to get people to do stuff using approach and avoidance, or carrots and sticks, offering a reward for working harder and giving punishments for falling short. But we know now that there's a better way to motivate people using intrinsic motivation. You probably already know about the differences between extrinsic and intrinsic motivation. Extrinsic rewards are tangible things like money or gifts. Intrinsic rewards are the more abstract feel-good things like satisfaction and achievement and recognition. What we know now is that we should use extrinsic and intrinsic rewards to motivate people in different ways. First, there are two types of work: heuristic and algorithmic. Basically, heuristic work takes a lot of critical thinking and decision-making. It makes up about 70% of job growth in our country, and it can't be outsourced because it takes specific skills like urban planning or engineering. Algorithmic work is simple, it's easy to outsource, and follows a set of rules, and makes up about 30% of US job growth. This is like working in a factory assembly line or a call center. So to motivate people, first, you have to figure out what kind of work you want them to do, heuristic or algorithmic. You can motivate people to do algorithmic work with extrinsic rewards, something tangible like offering a bonus or job security. For tasks or goals that do not require creativity or is not very interesting, people will tend to work harder for at least a short period of time when they're given that tangible extrinsic reward. But motivating people to do heuristic work is trickier. It's better to motivate them using intrinsic rewards. Intrinsic motivation helps us be creative, and being offered extrinsic rewards makes us less creative. Heuristic tasks take creativity. So you can motivate people to do heuristic work like graphic design by helping them feel satisfied, acknowledged, and competent in their jobs, by helping them achieve personal growth at work, by giving them extra education so they can do a really good job at what they already like, by praising them in front of their peers for their successes and giving them specific positive feedback and useful information. People want to know how they're performing at work, and telling them that they're doing a good job is its own reward. Most importantly, you can motivate people by helping them enjoy the work they do. That's the best motivator. Other ways you can reward people with intrinsic incentives are giving them independence at work, helping them find joy in their workday, engaging with them, helping them have satisfying relationships in their workplace and connecting with others, and giving them challenges that match their skill level. Work in our world is becoming less and less algorithmic and more heuristic. Think about all the types of new tech and virtual jobs people are doing. Offering people simple rewards and punishments like docking pay or giving raises won't work for the direction we're going. If you were to walk into any of the co-working spaces in Missoula, like the Loft or C3 Work Lounge, you'd see a bunch of people working remotely or for themselves at their own laptops, doing tasks that require critical thinking and creativity, like photography or event planning. Especially here in Montana, we're seeing lots of people working in an entrepreneurial space doing that heuristic work. A lot of times, one of the first things we think about when we think about how to motivate people is money. But you should know that money is often the most expensive way to get people to do things. When we offer people money in a situation where we should be focusing on our relationship instead, we can actually demotivate them. There are a lot of situations in which it makes more sense to think about our relationships. For example, an entrepreneur friend of mine recently asked me to help her get ready for a big pitch competition. Because we're friends, I would have actually been offended if she had ended our conversation by getting out her wallet to pay me. Also, in order to motivate people with money, you have to make sure that all their other needs are met first. Money doesn't motivate people for the long term if they aren't making a living wage first. They need their baseline needs met. Think about Maslow's hierarchy of needs before money will motivate them for real. For example, researchers did a study on people at Intel at a plant where people made the computer chips. They offered a few different types of rewards to motivate people: money, pizza voucher, or compliments. The HR managers at the plant thought that the cash would definitely work best to motivate people, but they found that all three worked equally well. The pizza voucher and compliment boosted productivity about 7% and cash only about 4%. So what does this tell us? That any reward is often better than no reward, but money's not always the most effective one. In fact, on the second day of the study, the cash reward led people to perform 13% worse. And with money, you'll often have to offer people a higher and higher cash reward in order to motivate them. One other way to think about rewards is contingent rewards versus anytime rewards. Contingent rewards are when you tell people that they'll get rewards if they complete some kind of task. Anytime rewards are rewards that obviously give to people anytime. So how do these two types of rewards motivate people? Even though we tend to think that we should offer rewards on that contingent basis, anytime rewards can be more motivational. Take, for example, a mobile rewards platform called Kip. When you play games online, you'll get a message from Kip telling you that you won a prize. Kip founder Brian Wong understands that anytime rewards can get people engaged because they get a reward even when they aren't expecting it. It treats them like they're worthy, not just because they did a task, but because they're a person. And that makes everybody feel good. People often respond better to things that are obviously not just carrots we dangle in front of them to try to motivate them. Kip even measured how people responded to contingent versus anytime rewards and found that people redeemed anytime rewards more often than when they were contingent. It's that element of surprise that can be a reward in itself too. Now, there are four things that managers do to motivate people that actually demotivate them instead. First, using extrinsic rewards to try to motivate people to do the work that they already enjoy can actually demotivate them and make them less productive. So when you try to motivate people with the wrong type of reward, you will not only not make them more productive, but you can actually make them less productive. Research tells us that when work requires even just a little bit of critical thinking, offering people bigger extrinsic rewards makes them perform worse and worse. When bonuses get really large, performance actually tends to decrease dramatically. Think about someone who just got a huge Christmas bonus check. That person probably doesn't think, wow, now I need to go make sure I work really hard so I earn that bonus. Instead, they'll probably think they can take a break as a little reward for earning the bonus. There's something called the Sawyer effect, which tells us that sometimes when we offer people extrinsic rewards for creative, interesting, or selfless tasks, they'll make them less motivated to follow through. It can make those tasks seem like a chore. And this starts when we're really young. For example, when researchers offered preschoolers who liked to draw extrinsic rewards for their drawings, they drew less and enjoyed it less. Research also tells us that when we use extrinsic rewards, when we should use intrinsic ones, people can end up acting more unethically, like cooperating less, cheating more, and taking bigger risks at work. Why? Because extrinsic rewards make us focus on the short term. We think less about the consequences of our behavior and more about what's happening right now. Second, you should know that extrinsic rewards tend to only motivate people for a short period of time. Intrinsic rewards can motivate people for the long term. Helping people feel satisfied and achieve personal growth might take more time and effort for you, but it can pay off in the long run. For example, extrinsic rewards might be good for attracting people to a job, but it won't sustain them being productive for a long time. When you reward people by helping them find real purpose in their work, an intrinsic reward, they'll tend to be much more motivated. Third, if you want to use extrinsic rewards to motivate people, you should make them surprising. Research using brain scanners shows that when people are offered a surprising reward, their reward centers light up and give them more pleasure. In fact, the surprise is its own reward. Like buying the office an espresso machine might be more surprising and motivational in the short term than buying lunch every Friday. Fourth, when you're trying to motivate people to do really boring stuff that you can't make more interesting, like filing papers or assembling something, you should do three things. Tell them why the task's important, acknowledge that, yeah, it's really boring, and let them do it their own way. Giving them that acknowledgement and a little bit of freedom tends to get people more motivated to follow through. To summarize, humans are motivated in two ways, with extrinsic and intrinsic rewards. The best way to motivate people is to think about what kind of task you want them to do and match that task to the type of reward that will work best. Doing this backwards can actually demotivate people instead. So to be a great leader and motivate a team in the long run, it's a great idea to think about how to give them those intrinsic rewards.